Very good evening. You're watching Primetime. I'm Tamanna Inamdar. Let's get straight to the headlines. Three bidders submit resolution plans for Essar Steel. New Metal joins hands with JSW Steel. ArcelorMittal and Vedanta are the other two bidders. RBI comes to the rescue of banks weighed down by rising bond yields, allows banks to spread out the mark-to-market hit taken on their bond portfolios over a period of four quarters. ICICI Bank falls nearly 6% as the private lenders' dealings with the Videocon group lands on the SEBI and CBI's radar. Markets start FY19 on a positive note. All the sectoral indices except banking close the day in the green. And the auto sector closes FY18 on a high. Most automakers register strong double-digit growth in March. At least five people are killed as protests against a Supreme Court ruling on the Scheduled Caste, Scheduled Tribe Atrocities Act turns violent. Well, the race for Essar Steel seems to be down to three players now. This after lenders of Essar Steel invited fresh bids for the stressed steel asset after disqualifying all earlier bids. Vishwanath Nair joins us for more on this story, which has seen so many twists and turns because two of the earlier bidders are in court trying to overturn that disqualification, and there's a new player now.
Yeah, so not only are they fighting on one end to be eligible and consider that previous bid eligible, they've also submitted a fresh bid, so both New Metal and ArcelorMittal. Now, the third bidder is Vedanta Group, the Anil Agarwal-led group. They've entered this race. They want to buy Essar Steel. That's why they've submitted a resolution plan. But of course, this whole conversation then becomes about this very high interest in Essar Steel, but a very small time frame, because 29th of April is when the 270-day deadline for the whole insolvency process ends. It's a very short time frame left for these new bids to be considered, if they are. Because if remember that the NCLT in Ahmedabad has ordered that on the 4th of April, when they decide on the eligibility, only after that will the lenders be able to open these bids. Let's say the NCLT decides that the first two bidders were eligible, then the whole rebidding process goes for a toss, and then we are not sure what happens to Vedanta's bid then.
So in this second round of bidding, which is conditional on what the NCLT says, there's also a new participant along with New Metal, which is JSW Steel. The press release has come in a little while ago where they've said that they will be joining in the capacity of investor. Now, what does this mean? Why? How has JSW Steel now come into the picture?
So they haven't described what is the structure under which JSW has entered this whole system. But what they are saying is that they've tied up with New Metal in this whole bidding process, and they are entering as investors. So they're not actually classified as a resolution applicant, which is the person who actually submits this a resolution plan for an insolvent company. So they're not classified as resolution applicants, but they are investors for the resolution applicant. How this structure has come about, whether this was already in talks, whether this came up only after the whole ineligibility conversation started, all of these things will get clearer as the day goes by. Obviously, this is still a developing story. It's only been a few hours since the bidding process got over. And obviously, JSW statement is only like 30 minutes old now.
Okay, so a story with a lot of twists and turns, and of course we'll be keeping an eye on it. Thank you so much, Vishwanath, for joining us on that big story. Now, another insolvency case that is stuck in a legal tangle is that of Binani Cement. In the latest, a decision on an out-of-court settlement between Binani Cement and the Committee of Creditors has been put on hold after the lenders said the debt-laden company failed to provide a detailed repayment plan. Remember, the NCLT has suggested an out-of-court settlement based on the proposed deal between Ultratech Cement and Binani Industries for a buyout of Binani Cement. This deal, however, was outside the ambit of the ongoing resolution process. Ultratech's initial bid for Binani Cement was unsuccessful. Moving on to markets now, Indian equity benchmarks rebounded from the first quarterly drop since December 2016, led by strong gains by automakers and drug companies. Both the Nifty and Sensex closed with gains of close to 1%. Navneet D'Souza now takes us through all the market action in this report.
It was a great session for both the benchmarks as well as the broader market indices. The Nifty closed above the mark of 10,200. Not only that, we closed above 200-day DMA as well of 10,180. Sensex closing the day with gains of nearly 286 points. It was a great session actually for the broader markets, which outperformed the benchmark indices. So you had the Nifty Bank actually that was pretty much weak, and that was owing to the pressure that was seen because of the PSU and the private banking space. But I was talking about the broader markets, almost 2% higher for the Nifty Mid-Cap Index. Nifty Small-Cap Index was up almost 1.7% in trade. Looking at the Nifty gainers, clearly the day belonged to two sectors. One of them was the pharma space. So Cipla, Lupin were your top gainers, gains of between 5 to 6%. And also the other gainers on Nifty today were stocks like Kotak Mahindra Bank as well as Adani Ports. On the losing side, like I was mentioning, Bank Nifty did not perform well because of heavy weights like ICICI Bank, that being the top loser, down 6%. Axis Bank also came under pressure. And you also had State Bank of India. That too was down in today's session. These are all your heavy weights. And the Nifty PSU Banking Index was down closer to 1% in trade. But Tata Motors and Maruti Suzuki, well, we kick-started the new month with monthly sales number for the month of March and double-digit growth coming across the board. So Maruti and as well as Tata Motors registered gains. You had Escorts, that saw a jump of nearly 8% in trade, and also something like Hero Motor Corp 2 registered growth of nearly 20% for the month of March. And not only about the auto pack, the rally extended to the auto ancillary stocks as well. So Jai Bharat Maruti was locked in upper circuit with gains of 20%. Something like Jamna Auto, that saw strong buying momentum in today's session, that saw gains of about 7%. Well, on the losing side, divestment called off by Canara Bank. They were looking to divest stake in Canfin Homes, and on back of that news, you had Canfin Homes, that was your top loser among the F&O securities. Huge amount of shorting seen, and Canara Bank finally managed to close the day in green in today's session. Some of the F&O gainers were Hexaware, registering gains of 10%. Jastile, after a lot of sessions, we saw gains of 9%. Both these stocks went up on good amount of volume on the cash side, and also some bit of long positions were seen. Two listings today, new kids on the block, Harda Construction, not a great listing at all, 20% lower for this one. Sandhar Technologies managed to open the day in the green, but towards the end, there was some selling pressure that was seen. But on a net-net basis, it was a good start to FY19. At least Nifty managed to close above the 200-day moving average level, which market participants keenly watch out for.
Now, ICICI Bank took a beating in trade today on the back of the news surrounding its CEO and MD, Chanda Kochhar's alleged conflicts of interest in loans extended to Videocon and New Power. While most brokerage houses have adopted a wait-and-watch stance, Bernstein has raised the red flag on the situation. Shraddha Babla gets us this report on what all the brokerage houses are saying.
So what Bernstein is saying is that the proofreads have now only escalated with the CBI getting involved, and hence they've advised caution. They've also said that the stock price will be weighed down in the near term on account of these developments. They also say that ICICI Bank deserves a lower multiple as compared to some of the quality private sector banks like HDFC Bank or Kotak Mahindra Bank. Having said that, ICICI Bank already trades at significantly lower multiples as compared to some of these banks. So Bernstein has maintained an underperformed rating with a target price of 220. Now with respect to what some of the other brokerages are saying, starting off with Macquarie, they've said that they will be watchful of the developments of the Videocon case, but having said that, they've said that ICICI Bank now trades only at one time its FY20 expected price to book value ratio. Additionally, the bank, they believe, is not or unlikely to require fresh capital despite the NCLT haircuts and IFRS implementation, and hence there is a low dilution risk for the bank, mainly on account of its ability to monetize subsidiaries at good valuations, and hence they have maintained an outperform rating with a target price of 425. Similar view coming in from IDFC Securities when it comes to valuations. They're saying that the bank's business trades below book value on FY20 expected numbers. Hence, they currently maintain an outperform with a target price of 390, though they do see pressure on the stock in the near term. And finally, you have Goldman Sachs, which has said that they believe that the latest step by the management to address the concerns in a press release will go a long way in reassuring investors about the bank's lending practices, and they've also said that they see greater corporate engagement as a positive, and hence they have maintained their buy rating with a target price of 410. So brokerages, while they clearly see depressed stock price performance in the near term and remain watchful of further developments, given the not so pricey valuations, they have refrained from revising either their ratings or target price on ICICI Bank.
All right, the Reserve Bank of India has stepped in to provide relief to banks which have been weighed down by not just bad loans, by rising bond yields as well. The regulator allowed banks to spread out the mark-to-market hit taken on their bond portfolios over a period of 4 quarters. The move comes as bond yields have risen sharply over the past 6 months on concerns over excessive government bond supply. This in turn has meant that banks have had to incur losses on their bond portfolios by marking down prices. Now, the auto sector closed FY18 on a high. Leading automakers clocked double-digit sales growth in the month of March. Yatin Mota now gets us all the data.
It was a solid month of March wherein automakers have posted a very healthy growth, not only in FY18, but also for the month of March. Starting with automaker Maruti Suzuki, they posted a 15% growth in total sales, which came in little over 1.6 lakh units. Also, Mahindra and Mahindra automotive segment performed satisfactorily. Total domestic sales were up for the company at close to 58,650 units. The tractor segment also saw some good growth, came in above estimates. Growth was almost 50% for the month of March on a year-on-year basis. Tata Motors also, not only the momentum in the commercial vehicle segment continued, but also the passenger vehicle segment saw some good growth for Tata Motors. Total sales were up 35% for the auto major. Ashok Leyland continues the momentum, 20% growth seen for the month of March. We have the total sales coming in little over 22,450 units. And coming to the two-wheeler players as well, starting with Royal Enfield, Aisha Motors posted a 25% growth in their motorcycle business. Not only that, we have TVS Motors, which posted a smart 27% growth, which came in at 3.2 lakh units. Bajaj Auto, the momentum not only continues in the domestic market because of the good growth in the motorcycle as well as the three-wheeler business, but also the export markets did well for the company, 23% growth seen there. And Hero MotoCorp, and what a month of March it has been, record sales which came in at 7.3 lakh units. Total volumes for the company were up 20% in March. So a good show coming in for the two-wheeler players, and also the commercial vehicle segment showing robust growth for the last 3 to 4 months.
Now, Finance Secretary Hasmukh Adia today said that although FY18 was a year of uncertainty in terms of revenue, the centre is confident of meeting the fiscal deficit target. Adia also stated that the direct tax collection figures have exceeded the ascertained target for the year and are expected to go up further.
Both in direct and indirect tax revenue, we have broadly met our target, and we are very much on course to achieve our fiscal deficit target. We are absolutely confident that we are meeting the fiscal deficit target of this year.
Now, the e-way bill system for transport of goods have been implemented yesterday. 2.98 lakh traders have registered for e-way bills. So what exactly are these e-way bills and how do they work? Take a look at this special report.
Imagine a truck carrying 100 bales of cotton from Mumbai to Surat. Right now, it needs to carry the tax invoice or the delivery challan along with the goods. But come February, goods that need to be transported from one state to another will need to carry an e-way or an electronic way bill. Think of it as an online registration of who is supplying to whom, where and how much. Now here's what will happen when the e-way bill system is implemented. The supplier, receiver or transporter of the goods will be able to generate this document on the e-way bill website before the goods start moving. You could club several deliveries on the same transport, but each of those will need a separate e-way bill number. Change of transport mid-journey will also require a fresh e-way bill. And here's the information e-way bills will capture. Goods and services tax identification number, place of delivery, invoice number, invoice date, nature of goods, value of goods, HSN code, etc. Anyone making a sale, transfer or exchange of goods exceeding 50,000 rupees for a distance of more than 10 kilometers will need to carry this bill along. It'll be valid for one day for a distance of up to 100 kilometers, an additional day for every 100 kilometers or part of it after that. If the goods are not delivered within the validity period, a fresh bill will need to be generated.
Here's some news that's going to hit the common man hard. Petrol and diesel prices have surged to record levels in the last couple of weeks, in line with global crude price trends as well. Petrol prices in Delhi hit a four-year high, while that of diesel hit levels never seen before. In Mumbai, petrol prices have crossed the 80 rupee per litre mark. Remember, fuel prices are not regulated by the government anymore. Oil Minister Dharmendra Pradhan today said the government is keeping a close eye on international prices, but added that there was no going back on free market pricing. He, however, did say that if fuel was bought under the GST, consumers would stand to gain.
Petroleum products are international commodity. Whenever there is a price hike in crude oil, there are some pinching price in Indian market also. Again, I will appeal to the GST Council through a consensus. Finally, this product has to come into the GST framework. Consumers should get rational price in all over country.
Now, Biocon wants to increase its focus on biosimilars. The drug maker, which recently got an approval for an insulin drug which is jointly being developed with Mylan, has set a target of $70 to $100 million over the next 2 years. Bloomberg Quint spoke early in the day with Biocon CMD Kiran Mazumdar-Shaw. Here's a bit of that conversation.
As a company pursuing biosimilars, we are the only company really addressing global opportunities out of India. I think this is an extremely crucial year for us. Last year has been a great year for us because of the trastuzumab approval that we got from the US. And of course, we've ended the year with the Semglee approval from Europe. So that has absolutely got us off to a good start. I think this year we expect many, many more approvals like you've just mentioned. And I think biosimilars is certainly a business strategy that has worked well for us. We do not see aggressive competition for many years yet, because I think it's only now that many companies have started investing in biosimilars, and by the time these programs are developed and brought to the market, we know that it will take a few years yet for many of these companies to really start catching up. So I think from that point of view, we are very pleased that we are amongst the front runners. And, you know, that actually gives us an early mover advantage. I think having a partner like Mylan has been extremely good for us, because we are very confident that Mylan is going to, you know, look at the commercial opportunity in a way that really focuses on getting a maximum market share. So, you know, we're looking forward to the next few years as being bonanza years for Biocon. I think we have basically vindicated ourselves in terms of making these big bets and big investments into biosimilars over the last several years. And I think today investors are beginning to feel very positive about, you know, the business model and the business strategy that we have adopted.
Kiran, one final quick word before we wrap up the interview on Semglee. Morgan Stanley believes that you could generate $70 to $100 million top line in two years. Is this something that you are working with?
Well, I think that's certainly very doable. I think the opportunity is much larger, but I do believe that that's a very doable target.
Now, the process of filing petitions for H-1B visas began today amidst unprecedented scrutiny by the Trump administration. The U.S. Citizenship and Immigration Services has warned that it will reject multiple applications for the same visa seeker. The USCIS has also indicated there will be zero tolerance even for minor errors. The H-1B visa has an annual cap of 65,000 visas each fiscal year. NASSCOM Vice President Shivendra Singh says H-1B workers will be in demand as long as skills gap exists in the U.S. He also says NASSCOM is working to ensure a level playing field for all Indian professionals in the United States.
As you see more of digital disruption and big data, cloud, robotics, artificial intelligence, you will see a change where a lot of companies will have to put resources nearshore, onshore, and you will see a lot of local hiring happening as we speak. So It's very much the demand of business, and that's how companies will go by. It's important that a level playing field is provided to our member companies to operate and add value to the economy, and that is what we look for, that there are no discriminatory measures, but all companies are impacted alike in case of any decision which is taken either administratively or legislatively.
Now, Dalit outfits called a nationwide strike today against the alleged dilution of the SC-ST Prevention of Atrocities Act by the Supreme Court. Violent protests erupted in several parts of the country, leaving six dead and several injured. Curfew was imposed in at least three districts of Madhya Pradesh. The CBSE postponed its class 12 and 10 examinations in Punjab that were scheduled to be held today in view of the Bandh. Meanwhile, Madhya Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh and Punjab have requested aid from central forces. Congress President Rahul Gandhi has slammed the center for the plight of Dalits, while Union Minister for Home Rajnath Singh appealed for peace.
अस्पृश्यता और कास्ट वायलेंस इन दोनों को डील करने में इस दोनों को खत्म करने में केंद्र और सारे स्टेट की गवर्नमेंट फेल गई है ये ऑनरेबल एपेक्स कोर्ट को भी मालूम है बावजूद उसके कुछ फर्जी एट्रोसिटी के मुकदमों के चलते एक जनरलाइज्ड ऐसा कमेंट करना कि दलित समाज के लोग एट्रोसिटी के कानून का ब्लैकमेल के लिए इस्तेमाल करता है और इसके चलते सारे एसपी को एक डायरेक्शन देना कि पहले आप प्राइमरी इन्वेस्टिगेशन करेंगे उसके बाद ही गिरफ्तारी होगी ये कहीं ना कहीं एट्रोसिटी के कानून जो स्पेशल लेजिस्लेशन है उसके महत्व को करीब करीब घटा देने की कम करने की बात है
जो आंदोलन कर रहे थे इनके आड़ में उनको बलि का बकरा ना बनाया जाए ये भी मेरा शासन प्रशासन से ये कहना है और यदि ऐसा किया गया तो हमारी पार्टी चुप नहीं बैठेगी और फिर हमारी पार्टी इसको लेकर जबरदस्त आवाज उठाएगी
सभी राजनीतिक दलों की नैतिक जिम्मेदारी बनती है कि ऐसे समय में सभी अपनी तरफ से प्रयत्न करें और सहयोग करें ताकि किसी भी जातिगत तनाव अथवा सांप्रदायिक तनाव की स्थिति इस देश में पैदा न होने पाए
बड़े आदर के साथ हम कहना चाहते हैं उस निर्णय के निष्कर्ष से और उस निर्णय के तर्कों से हम असहमत हैं तो सरकार की ओर से एक रिव्यू फाइल किया गया है सरकार खुद भी पार्टी नहीं थी हमारी पूरी कोशिश होगी कि इस रिव्यू पर विस्तार से चर्चा सुप्रीम कोर्ट में हो
Right, back to the big corporate story. The race for Essar Steel seems to be down to three players. This after lenders of Essar Steel invited fresh bids for the stressed steel asset after disqualifying all earlier bids. The new player, of course, is Vedanta. And Anil Agarwal, chairman of Vedanta, who has joined that race, is talking to us now on the phone line. Thank you so much for speaking with us on Bloomberg Quint, Mr. Agarwal.
Yes, thank you very much.
Okay. My first question, sir, your bid comes at a time when both New Metal and ArcelorMittal are hoping that the first round of bids that they have made, which were disqualified, go through. They've gone to courts on that. So you have a chance that this bid of yours will really go nowhere. Is that a risk you've taken, sir?
No, there is no risk. There is no risk. I only go that the bid was invited by AP with the and the NCLT process, and we were the eligible bidder, and we have bid. We have bid in the because it was we are eligible, and we put the bid very. And the court, whatever courts, they have gone to the court. I'm not following the process, but I know for sure that the bid was due today and we put in our best bid.
Why now, Mr. Agarwal, and why not earlier? There were you were part of the earliest expression of interest, but later on, Vedanta chose not to participate for this asset. What has changed now?
Yeah, that process was a couple of months back. And as you know, that we are one of the largest producers of iron ore. Steel has the highest growth in India. In the world, India would be the one of the highest growth in India, and to build the Essar as one of the finest asset, and it's not easy to build that these assets soon. You know, in India only produce 60, 70 million ton of steel, is going to need 300 million ton of steel. This Mr. Modi has said a couple of times that he's very keen the steel production to be up and to produce iron ore. So we were the iron ore producer. It was the right thing for us, for the value addition, to go for it. We got the electro steel. We thought putting these two together, we'll be sizable in line with the others, in line with the others, similar capacity we can create. At the same time, Essar needed the gas because it is a gas base is one of the best plant for the steel, but they were not getting enough gas. And Cane produce gas and the pipeline come up to the close to the Essar plant is. So it will be a great advantage that we'll be able to supply. Is my vision. We'll be able to supply the gas. We'll be able to supply the iron ore. And in the growth market of India, you have seen whatever we have acquired last 15, 20 years in the past. We have always double, triple the capacity. We have made the plant most modern. So I'm hoping and I'm looking forward if this plant, if the bid, successful bid I get through, we'll be very excited to take this forward, to make this plant better size and be very exciting for our company.
Absolutely.
Also, you know, our balance sheet, which was not leveraged, we have only $4 billion debt and which we can take easily quite a good debt. So, and the bank was very favorable. They always wanted Vedanta to come forward and bid for this asset. So these all were advantages one after other and we thought this is the best thing for our shareholder and go and bid for this asset.
No, absolutely. You've explained in detail why strategically Essar Steel seems attractive to you. So if I may repeat my question, Mr. Agarwal, my question is why now? Is the fact that the earlier two bidders were rejected on certain grounds led to an impetus to now throw your hat in the ring for Essar Steel?
No, but see, one was, we have very good harmony among ourselves, whether it's Mr. Mittal or Mr. Ruya or Sajan Jindal. We all are in the same. And when one was, the Essar was bidding for it, and we were looking for electro steel at that time. And then we find that the situation in a couple of months has changed. We are closing our balance sheet in the March. And we get excited. We put up this to our board. They also very excited. We talk to our banker. And it is everything has a time. So this was the right time. It has come at the right time. And we bid for it. It was not that before or now. At that time, we were looking electro steel to complete. And that was complete. And now this thing has come. So we come into this process. And I'm not saying I'm going to get this. Whoever is the best bidder will get this asset. But because we have come in, the bank has done a fantastic job in this because of we have also come in, probably they will get a better price. And the way they have run the process, I really appreciate the way they run the process. It is, they have been very sharp, they have run the process well, and because we have come in and they created a good competition among everybody, so they will be best advantageous position to get a better price.
Are there any details you can share with us, Mr. Agarwal, about the bid for Essar Steel?
No, it's not fair. It is a very transparent process and bid will be open in a few days.
Okay.
And you will know everything.
What about electro steel? Because you are pretty much at the finishing line in that process. Can you tell us in a little more detail how electro steel and then if Essar Steel goes through works into your larger plan?
Yeah, this will be one of our vertical. If you look at, we produce aluminium. We produce largest aluminium in the country. We produce largest copper in the country. We produce 30% oil of the country. We produce one of the largest iron ore. We produce copper. So these are the vertical. I'm very natural resource person, and we created this company. And electro steel, because I come from Jharkhand area, Bihar, so it was very close to my heart to have something giving back to my state and my area. So as my nature, I'm going to expand this plant. I'm looking forward to make more investment in electro steel. We got the letter of intent for that. We submitted the bank guarantee. So the process is gone. Process is on. So I'm looking forward how we can look at and add more value to the electro steel. So this will be electro steel. Is look like it is done. And then the we have put in a bid for the SR, and as and when result comes, we will look forward to whatever we can do best for my country, for this plant, and for my iron ore or for my gas.
Okay, you spoke a little while ago about how all of you among the bidders have good relations and how the timing seemed to be right. Well, the timing seemed to be right for one more player. JSW Steel has announced a little while ago that it will be partnering with New Metal in the bids. We don't have all the details of in what capacity and what the exact contours are, but do you think it changes the entire situation a little bit, and perhaps your chances as well?
No, I have. I'm really not looking. I really wish everybody well, and if their bids are better, they will get it. And if our bids are better, we will get it. So whatever when the bid open, whoever give the best bid, and whatever the NCLT process decide, that's fine.
Okay. If the NCLT process decides that the original two bidders can continue through, and effectively your bid would then not stand, would Vedanta then look at legal routes as well?
I have no idea at all. I've not looked at anything. We don't look at that far. We only look at what we have in front of us. We have in front of us that there is something which is available to bid, and with our best of knowledge, best of effort, we put in everything together and put in a bid. And whatever come out of it, we will accept it.
I guess what I'm trying to ask you, Mr. Agarwal, is how keen are you on Essar Steel at this point? How aggressively will you pursue it?
You know, I have never, I have done always strategically. We have acquired 8-10 assets in the past, and every asset we have always remained on the side to see what result comes out. We have never played the game, so-called game. We remain always that whatever the other side will decide, we'll accept it.
All right. Thank you so much for speaking with us. Anil Agarwal, chairman of Vedanta there, speaking about him joining the race, his company joining the race for Essar Steel, and talking about what that process may unfold. Thank you so much. And coming up on Primetime Debate, just a quick programming reminder there, we'll be talking about the widespread protests across the country against the Supreme Court order of 20th of March, which has been perceived as reading down or diluting the Prevention of Atrocities Act against SC and ST groups. Is that really the case? We'll be talking about it with Aishwarya Bhatti. She's advocate in the Supreme Court and also a part of the BJP's legal cell. Chandrabhan Prasad will also be joining us in on that conversation. He's a Dalit ideologue. So stay tuned for that. We'll be right back with Primetime Debate in just a bit.